What is up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of Convincing Creatives Podcast, Season 3. Today we have a super exciting episode for you. Today I'm interviewing Kyle Sullivan. Kyle is a Birmingham, Alabama-based filmmaker who also does documentary and narrative work, so we have a lot to chat and relate on there. He's a fellow Nintendo video game fan, which we didn't get a chance to talk about as much on the podcast, but always feel like that's worth mentioning. We have a very awesome appreciation for the world of Legend of Zelda, which is always super dope. And we talk a lot about him going to Antarctica, working on documentary films, making YouTube videos over on his YouTube channel, which you should definitely go check out, and kind of where that falls in terms of, you know, YouTube film versus a film festival film, and kind of, is there a difference in today's day and age? I know that YouTube obviously commands a huge audience out there, but how do you get your work seen? So we also talk about that as a creative person, and where do you put your work at the end of the day? Because that's something I always struggle with and consider when I'm trying to launch anything I'm doing. So really super cool conversation out there. Kyle also is the host of the Star Trek trivia show on YouTube, Trekspertise, so you should go check that out. And it was really awesome to chat with him about his love for science fiction as well. So without any further ado, we'll jump in the episode. But first, gotta plug my latest project. It's called Panda Barrett. You should watch it. It's a film. It's 63 minutes long, so it won't take up too much of your day. And it's over on Tubi for free. Yes, free 99, free. So you can go stream it and let me know if you loved it or not. But at least it won't cost you anything. Just watch like 3 or 4 ads. So it's pretty cool. Glad we got that there. And if you want to rent or buy the film, it is also on Amazon. So just wanted to let you know that. Without any further ado, now let's jump right into the interview with Kyle Sullivan. Today we have Kyle Sullivan on the show. Kyle, welcome.
Hello.
Thank you for being here. Kyle, for folks who don't know who you are, what you're doing, obviously we'll get into all that, but could you just describe yourself as you see your creative journey unfolding currently?
I am a filmmaker?
I'd say so. I've seen a couple of your films, so I'd say you're a filmmaker.
I guess that's how it described me. There's a lot of asterisks, and yeah, everyone has asterisks, so I've got a bunch of those. So
yeah, everyone is a slash something, you know. You can't always just do one thing these days.
Exactly.
So yeah, man. Well, to kick things off, like, I know you're doing a couple different things. Obviously you've done filmmaking, but you're also doing some writing and podcasting and stuff like that. How do you balance the variety of projects that you do? Do you like to do different things to keep it interesting, or like, how do you go about that?
How do I balance?
Yeah,
I don't know. Normally I'd say you divvy your day or week or mm-hmm. month up so that you're giving attention to every little thing, but there's only so much creativity to go into the different piles, so that often gets rearranged on the fly. And as far as like media hopping, I guess, like why the different things, it just depends on what you're trying to communicate and what medium is best. You know, that if that makes any kind of sense.
1000%.
No,
1000%. I think it makes perfect sense. I do this podcast, you know, I'm a filmmaker as well. And like, for me, it's just a great way to keep a different part of my brain, you know, active and recharge the other one. And, you know, I find sometimes when I do these, obviously it's creative talk, so I get inspired by other people I'm talking to, but it kind of refreshes my love for filmmaking. And like, you know, I also play drums, and that, you know, is another outlet. And so I think it's always nice when creative people are able to balance things and do different things in different mediums and etc. So
yeah, man, the balance is the struggle, right? So like, everyone wants to be pie in the sky. I want to direct movies, I want to do X, I want to do Y. And it's really a matter of your ground game, is how well can you organize your time so that you can take incremental steps toward the goal. And like, it's so hard, because like, creativity is not something you can turn on and off. Sometimes it's a bolt of lightning inspiration. Most of the time it's a hard slog that it's a maze you can't find your way through. And like, 30 minutes, I'm going to do X to get out of this maze. 1 hour, I'm going to do X to get out of this maze. And like, sometimes you sit down with that hour and you're like, there's nothing, there's nothing here. And is that time management? I don't know. Sometimes it doesn't feel like it is at all.
It's creative chaos, I find a lot of times. Like when I first get an idea for something, I'll say, oh, that would be an amazing film. Then I sit with it a little bit and I'm like, I don't know, there's enough there for a full film, maybe a YouTube video, and then maybe it's a podcast. And then you kind of just have to whittle it down to different things, which is actually a good transition question because I know that you have a YouTube channel. I've seen a couple of your videos. I really enjoyed your series in Antarctica. Obviously would love to chat with you about that as well, but like in terms of just like strictly creating YouTube videos, like where does that differ from, you know, your more traditional films that would play at a festival or something like that?
I think that maybe back in the day prior to YouTube, it wouldn't have been that different. But also the medium being what it is, YouTube being what it is, it has become a much bigger difference. Deciding what to put where is interesting. I'm literally having this conversation with myself. I just got done with the Sidewalk Film Festival in Birmingham, Alabama,
Love
and
Sidewalk.
Sidewalk is my favorite. We had our short film, Garden of the Gods, play there. It was a Edgar Allan Poe remake. So like it's a very narrative rich kind of thing. And oftentimes that's not, in my experience, what YouTube is good at. There's a lot of short films on YouTube, and there are people doing skits and shorts and narrative things on YouTube. But oftentimes YouTube gets credit for being a different kind of space because people can just they can create quickly, but they can also create outside of the bounds, outside of the box, so to speak. So that's where the differences come in. Like video essays, which is we have a channel, Trexpertise, that's all about video essays. That I don't think would have found purchase anywhere in the film festival world. Not really. It was before the internet, it was not something you found a lot of. So like, can you make a video essay? Can you make a YouTube style video and go the festival circuit with it? That's a great question.
It
I have no
depends.
idea.
Yeah, I think it depends on what you're doing. Like, but I've found myself lately, I think part of it is because of like COVID. But I mean, I make it's a movie at the end of the day. It's a, you know, short documentary or something. But I think to myself, well, you know, I could put this on the festivals and to do that rigmarole for a year, and then maybe it'll end up on YouTube anyway, or I can just put it on YouTube now and kind of just be done with it. And you know, I'm not saying one's any better than the other, because I love film festivals. Like, speaking of Sidewalk, that is one of my favorite film festivals I've been to. Like, I went there in 2018 with a short doc I did called We Live the Blues, and I just had such a great time, met so many cool people. And I think that's why we ended up connecting, because I met Jeremy Burgess down there in Birmingham. Yeah. And so I think I've seen some of his tweets, and I think that's how I found you on Twitter. And you know, it's been just really cool, like the amount of people I've met through that one time going. So it's a great fest. And so again, that's the beauty of festivals, is the community that you're just, you know, not always going to get on YouTube unless you're a larger channel. So
Exactly. Yeah. I think as a filmmaker, the decision to go one way or the other with something really comes down to what you need to get out of it. Like if networking is something you need to do, or if you have a film you're trying to sell, for example, you're not going to do that on YouTube. You can,
No.
but it's much more rewarding and it's much better an experience to do that in person. If you just want to put something in front of an audience and see what they do, man, no better invention than the YouTubes. Like instant gratification, instant feedback. Oh, is this decision good? No, thanks. I appreciate it.
It's awesome that you can just get like instant feedback in that way, because people on YouTube, for better or worse, they will let you know if they're feeling it, if they're not feeling it. You know, it's just the way the internet algorithm just works these days. But no, it's really interesting. Like, I always find myself thinking now, is this a YouTube video? Because during COVID, I really like revamped my YouTube channel, and so it's been an interesting like experiment to see what works where. And you know, I've put some of my bigger projects eventually on YouTube, like once they run their course at the festivals and ETC. But you know, I find it's almost two separate styles, and obviously like podcasting too. Where are you seeing that going? Because I know you're hosting on two different podcasts and doing different things with your Star Trek series on YouTube. And
I don't podcasting is a funny thing because like it's for the world at large, it's a way to get your voice out there on whatever topic you're about and however that happens. Like most of the time it's just like two dudes talking. For me, podcasting is all about cinematic sound design. So like the reason I wanted to get into that was so that I could paint narrative pictures. with sound, and I wanted to learn more about that. And so maybe mine isn't a representative case. And I'm not sure if podcasting is going in that direction generally. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely depends. Like, I'm a big fan of both styles. Like, I mean, you know, interview-based is fun, but it's very simple. It just depends what you need to get out of it. But I find sometimes when I have that hunger for something a little more story-wise, narrative-based, I will go to the sound design type of, you know, podcast. And they're beautiful because they're essentially a documentary minus the, you know, visuals. So,
yeah. Exactly. Those are my favorite. I'm a huge fan of like Radiolab and what's the name of that series that Amazon put out that was based on a podcast that had Julia Roberts in it. Oh,
I think I know what you're talking about, but I can't. It is escaping me as
home,
well.
Home something. It's a very generic name. Okay. Anyway, its podcast predecessor is super rich, super clever writing. I'm just like, yeah, more of this, please.
Yeah.
But every now and then, you know, I just got to listen to an interview because I need you to survive.
No, it's I get obviously the reason I do this, but it's it helps. It like keeps me going when I have the creative doubts and struggles and things like that. Speaking of which, I'm very curious. I know you're also a fellow lover of space and geography and things like that. Can you talk about maybe how that keeps your brain creative? Because, you know, I find myself a lot of times going down weird rabbit holes about, you know, exoplanets and weird things like that. And, you know, I before I know it, 3 hours have gone by and I'm like, oh, I got way off topic. I need to get back to my edit.
So. I think that's exactly it. A lot of filmmakers will focus only on craft and gear.
Yeah.
And that's good. You need to know those things. But I think in order to be a successful filmmaker at whatever level of success, you got to fill your brain with something else, something far beyond the artistic expression. Otherwise you're not gonna have anything to talk about. So like reading, falling down rabbit holes, spending hours on Wikipedia, getting an expertise in exoplanets, man, you don't know how that's going to inform you, but it will inform you whatever you choose to express.
Yeah, no, I think it's interesting,
extremely important.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I love that. Like it's so fun. And like, I think it's an interesting meld of like art and science, left and right brain, just things that, you know, make you a whole person, like you said, to give you a perspective and things to talk about as an artist and a filmmaker. And, you know, I think, again, and it does connect because like, I see you also love science fiction. Like, what do you get out of that? Because I find science fiction one of my favorite genres, but, you know, at the independent level, a lot of the films I've done, especially like outside of the, you know, New York, LA, Hollywood kind of industry system, they tend to be a lot more documentary and like kind of, you know, low budget drama comedy. But, you know, I still love science fiction. Like, how do you kind of balance that as a filmmaker who loves that kind of thing?
As far as like watching or creating?
Just both, like kind of taking it in and also maybe like, do you ever have the desire to make it? Because that's a hard genre to make a lot of times if you don't have, you know, budget and effects.
My wife and I, that's all we want to do is science fiction movies. Yeah. If we could give it all the rest of it up to do that, we would. So in my opinion, we're building toward that. But you're right. There's a to express your imagination in that realm, you have to be very clever or very rich.
Right.
And I'm not sure. I think we're leaning on clever, hopefully.
Yeah. It's usually the better way to lean, I think, sometimes. So,
yeah.
You know.
Just be smart about it. I think sci-fi is a conversation worth having in that we're not having it the right way right now as a culture.
Mm-hmm. I find a lot of the like interesting sci-fi like novels and books and shows, they'll tell those stories about stuff that we're dealing with here on Earth, on different planets and different places, and you're like, there's the parallel. So
exactly. Yeah. I think that's the magic of it, honestly. I mean, all science fiction, all stories really, but sci-fi seems the most distant. It's really, we're just talking about ourselves. That's all it is.
Because it's all we know. I mentioned it earlier, but I want to loop back around to Antarctica because I just think that's super interesting. Can you tell me about that experience? I mean, you know, that's obviously not something you get to do every day.
How do I describe it? I mean, it's the closest I've ever gotten to visiting another planet. It's so starkly different.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. As I'm a U.S. citizen, I'm an American. Antarctica makes our national park system look like a series of slums. It's so pristine and absolutely natural, and it will absolutely kill you at a moment's notice.
Yeah.
I don't know how to describe it exactly. except in superlatives, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, do you feel like after going, you don't see, you know, I mean, you mentioned it with the national park, see some things the same way just because you've been somewhere like that?
And... yeah, it completely changes you. In terms of like understanding and caring for the environment, for example, I was already predisposed before I left to be sensitive to this issue, just being in the nature that I'm in. But when you go to a place that fragile and you can see in person with your own eyes how fragile it is, you come back like almost a radical. You're like, this can't stand. Right. We can't let this continue. And just in terms of like the scale of the planet, how big the planet is, like we in North America zip around really quickly between cities and cars and airplanes and stuff, and 3 hours to Dallas, 2 hours to Atlanta, 4 hours to Seattle. Like it feels like we're continent hopping, but you get down to a place like Antarctica and you're like, I can't go 16 feet because there's a sudden blizzard, or it just radically changes your sense of scale. The planet feels so much bigger to me now than it did before. And I didn't realize, I thought it was small before. That's the thing. I'd say the takeaway for Antarctica is that it's going to open your eyes, but you have no idea to what. I'm still kind of processing that. And it's been a few years now, you know, it's like, yeah. Oh, wow. I used to think this way. No, I don't. Yeah.
No, that's fascinating. And I think like, I don't know about you, but as someone growing up, I always loved like maps and atlases and globes. I would just like look at them for ages and, you know, just see where things are in relation to other things. And I have never been to Antarctica, but I could only imagine that sounds super fascinating. Like just knowing you can't go but so far because, you know, there's not a road or there's not an airport or there's just a blizzard coming through that you could not survive as a human. Like that changes the game. Yeah.
100%, man. I hesitate to tell everyone to go down there, but if you get a chance, you should 100% go. Even if it's just to the Antarctic Peninsula, because even there, it's like...
Yeah. How did you end up going? Was it to make those videos? And like, how did the filmmaking logistics go as well in such a cold, harsh climate?
I won an online contest. Cool. So like, I just applied and got it. And one of the part of my pitch, I had to have people publicly vote on me, was that I would turn it into a series of videos. And I think that moved the needle. And so it was completely luck. And I turned it into work, so to speak. And I got companies to lend me gear, lenses and camera gear and stuff like that. And dealing with the cold and the salt water and the logistics of having everything be as handheld as possible and still be cinematic looking was a real challenge. And if the BBC regularly shoots documentaries in that part of the world, they always hire the same people, because once you figure out how to do it, once you sink the cost into doing that kind of filmmaking, like they're going to keep coming back to you. But I found I had a lot of problems, man. The cold absolutely will kill a battery real quick. So you have to do a lot of padding and keeping things warm. And I discovered that the Blackmagic cameras back then, the cinema cameras, absolute tanks. Like you could kick those things across the ice and they will absolutely keep shooting. And I was just amazed at how strong those cameras were. But yeah, it's a different thing. It's not like setting up a shot for a narrative at all. You know, the nature people, they have a really tough job. And if you're in an extreme environment like that, that's some of the hardiest filmmakers on the planet, in my opinion. The rest of us who get to edit in air conditioning have nothing to complain about.
Well, and that's interesting too, just about the logistics of the battery. Like I have the Blackmagic Pocket 4K that I just shot my last feature with. And I mean, that thing ate a battery every 15 minutes. And that's, you know, here in 80, 90 degree North Carolina weather, I can't imagine the flip of that. Like you would think, oh, cool environment, maybe it would lend itself to the battery, but that's not even cool. That's like frigid.
Yeah.
Like our brains in the US probably can't even comprehend that temperature.
I remember specifically one instance with there were penguins. Yeah. I was on land and I had camera backup battery. So the internal battery had gone, the backup battery, I had four of them and I was switching them every 2 minutes. I got maybe 10 minutes worth of footage before everything shut down. It was like negative 20 Fahrenheit or something crazy like that.
Yeah.
I'm wearing like 70 layers of clothes. I can barely move. And like, it just would just eat these fully charged batteries for breakfast. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
I need a lot of money to be able to just shoot regular down here.
Yeah.
Thanks, Antarctica.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, not to mention you're probably wearing like gloves on gloves, and then you have to, I don't know about the one you use, but I know the one I use has a touchscreen, and that's finicky with gloves and just like so many small logistics, you know. And by the time you're trying to get your penguin, it may have already walked away. Like,
yeah, exactly. Footage turned out great, but you know,
yeah,
it's like storming the beach. Like, you just get it, do it all at once, and then that's it. Enjoy nature after that.
Yeah.
But thankfully, it wasn't all like that. So
yeah, no, that's good. And you did capture some beautiful footage.
Thanks. I thought really it turned out okay.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed watching the episodes. Speaking of filmmaking, you mentioned like it's different than narrative. You seem to as well be a fellow filmmaker that does not just documentary but narrative as well, and how do you balance that? Because like I always find for myself, I think like I shoot, you know, my last feature, Panda Barrett, it's this weird narrative about like a rapper and his imaginary panda bear. It's like surreal drama and just crazy trippy fun, super different. And then the, you know, documentary I did before that was like a heartfelt look at flooding in Baton Rouge and from the 2016 floods when I lived down there. And you know, it was just total flip opposite, but I kind of needed to bounce back and forth. And like, you know, people ask, do you have a favorite? And I really don't. Like, I love both. They're very different. But I also don't meet a lot of people who do both as well. So I, like, I'm curious to get your take on that.
I also love both. And I'm a real softy. I love a good romantic comedy, for example, too, which is a film we're trying to make right now.
Fun.
So I don't know how else to describe it, except it's just interest-based.
Yeah.
My friend Ryan is fond of saying that filmmakers tend to try and make the same film over and over. That might be true of someone like Quentin Tarantino or something like that, but I don't feel that way at all. I feel like I have this thought, this germ of interest, and whatever emotional context is embedded in that determines where it lives. Like, does this need to be a documentary? Do I need to dramatize this real life event, or do I need to couch it in like a science fiction metaphor, or do I just need to go to YouTube and talk for 10 minutes, you know?
Yeah.
It just depends on what expression is warranted, I think. With YouTube and TikTok, I feel like the pressure is off. You can play very quickly and easily in other spaces and figure them out for yourself and see what's working in a much more general, robust way than filmmakers past could do.
It costs
so much money to do a thing, you know?
No, that's a great way to put it. Like, it's a space where you can really play, and the pressure, you know, it's not really quite there on a TikTok video or a YouTube video. Obviously, you know, you still want it to look good. You've got your skill set as a filmmaker, but you know, I definitely agree with that. Like, I remember a couple years ago, I made a video on YouTube about play and why that's important as a creative. And the genesis of that was, I was like, getting together with a friend, and I was talking about just feeling stuck on a project, and it just didn't feel like, I don't know, I just didn't feel the push for this particular project. And he was like, well, are you playing? Like, what are you doing? Like, you know, and I had just gotten so into this mode of just like making stuff, which is good, you know, in a way, because that's a skill set to keep moving and having momentum. But I wasn't like experimenting with my camera. I wasn't really trying new things. I was kind of, like you said, doing that same old thing, and it kind of inspired me to mix it up. So I feel like, yeah, you do have to keep yourself playing on your cinematic palette, no matter how many films you've made.
Exactly. I think it keeps you honest when you're doing the really big stuff, the big jobs, you know.
It's like, absolutely.
Well, you're fretting over the next shot. Well, what did I do for that stupid YouTube video 6 months ago?
I'll just
put myself in that mode.
Yeah. I've started a YouTube video I'm working on, which is literally about trees, and it's just like why I love trees, and it's so stupid. Like, I love trees because for some reason they make my brain feel good. But like, the more I'm diving into it, like, the more fun I'm having with it. And, you know, I don't think it's something I would send to a festival, but I don't know. It's like just a great exploration. Like,
first of all, hell yes. Trees are cool and awesome, and you should absolutely make a video about them. Now I want to watch it.
Okay, cool. I'll send it to you if I ever get it done. I'm hoping I will.
Also, the thing I'm finding now with the YouTube stuff is that people are hiring me because of how weird it is.
Yeah.
And like, I have a client right now with a very serious company who needs a very serious corporate video that I'm putting together. And he's like, make it more like your YouTube stuff. I'm like, dude, the tone will not match.
I love that.
And I find that more people are asking me for that. I'm just like, I was just goofing off over there.
Yeah. No, I think there is something there to that style because, well, and it's not even a style. It's just people playing, like experimenting, not having the constriction, because obviously, like, you know, I shoot corporate videos, that's how I make a living, and, you know, commercial videos and stuff like that. And, you know, it's very easy to just do a sit down talking head and shoot some B-roll of a person doing a thing and call it a day. And, like, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. It works. You can sometimes get really cool stuff from that. But how do you push yourself to kind of break those boxes? Like, because I think that's hard.
That is hard. I'm struggling with that really hard right now, actually, because yes, I do want to kick down the door and just make whatever's on the inside of my brain. Just do what I do on YouTube, is like, just be stupid, put it in a garbage disposal, blend it up and throw it in the edit and see what happens. But at the same time, I also want to get hired again.
Yeah.
So like,
that is a factor. Yeah.
You know, like, I don't want to get too crazy, and trying to find a balance between the style of it is something I'm banging my head against the desk about right now. I'm not sure how you do that.
So, speaking of filmmaking, I've had a couple filmmakers on this season. Do you see the democratization of filmmaking as a good thing? You know, obviously it's making more people able to make films, but sometimes it makes it feel like it's harder because, you know, just everyone's doing it. There's so many voices out there. And then how does that also factor into just like working outside of that, you know, New York, LA system?
Yes, it's a good thing. Yes, it makes it more difficult to stand out. But the solution to standing out is really easy. Don't pull your influences from where everyone else is pulling their influences from. Right now, I'm part of a whole generation of filmmakers that grew up on Spielberg. And everybody wants a taste of that still. Yeah. Even I do. Like, I would love to make an E.T. or yeah, something like that. That sounds perfect. I'd retire after that. But I think you won't be able to stand out. Your style, whatever it turns out to be, won't stand out. So I think part and parcel with this democratization of filmmaking gear, in order to make your presence known, you're gonna have to fill your head with something else. The rarer the knowledge you put inside your head, the cooler or the more different your artistic output is gonna be. And like I said, I'm part of a generation that grew up on Blockbuster Hollywood fare, and competing when everyone else has the same influences, that's what's hard.
Yes. Yeah. I think too, I look at the types of films that, you know, you and I make and other people who work as indie filmmakers, they're sort of their own thing. I mean, yes, they're still films, but, you know, I don't know that it's entirely the same thing as, like, you know, the newest Fast and Furious movie, which, again, nothing wrong with that. Those films are self-aware and they know what they are doing. And, like, you know, I'm not going to hate on that, but, you know, I think it's just sort of like, they're both films, but there's an apples oranges kind of situation too. Like,
yeah, exactly, they are. And if that's the space you want to play in, then
yeah,
go play in it, absolutely. And believe me, I would love to.
Yeah, I'd love to make a freaking Mandalorian episode. I mean, I love Star Wars. I mean, you know, give me the Baby Yoda animatronic puppet. I will put it to work, you know.
100%.
So, you know, while I wait for, but like, while I wait for my phone to ring on that situation, like, you know, I'm like, oh, I gotta be making some other stuff. And like, I know for me, like, I'm sure everyone has had a experience with, you know, the lockdown and COVID and like how you've reassessed things afterwards. But I know for me, like, that's part of why I'm making my stupid little video film about trees, is like, I don't know that I would have done that pre-pandemic, is because I would have taken what I was doing maybe not too seriously, because I've never taken it that seriously, but just I would have said, oh, you know, this couldn't play festivals, this would just be me goofing off. But now I'm putting a lot of value in me goofing off. Like, I think that's where I'm starting to, you know, see that year of like being stuck in your head, you know, it makes me just, you know, see things a little differently. It makes me see that, you know, maybe film festivals aren't always a guarantee, because they really were not a guarantee in 2020. And so you don't need to put so much stock in them. And, you know, they're still great. I'm not knocking them, but, you know, it's an interesting parallel, I think.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I mean, you know, the film festival question changes a little bit every year. I don't know what to do about that. But, you know, I think to cap on the democratization thing, I think that the chief component right now, if you're a studio or an independent or just a freelancer out in the Southeast somewhere, is that it comes down to content, where before they could overwhelm you with scale. The scale doesn't matter anymore. It has to be good, whatever it is. And everything else follows that. And I think even the studios are learning right now. I mean, it's real blockbuster fatigue going on, even with the Marvel stuff. And I think that the pivot to Mandalorian, for example, really excellent, but also they see the writing on the wall, you know, lead with the content, not the form factor. And maybe that's part of the future of this democratization. Maybe.
Yeah, no, I could see that. Now tell me, what do you love about making films? You know, for you in Birmingham, for me, it's North Carolina. Like, what do you love about making films in your region?
How long a podcast do you have?
Hey, let's chat about it. I know it's hard because you're not always around, you know, the quote unquote industry, but you know, for me, I find this strange magic and freedom in collaborating with, you know, four people on a weekend after our jobs and like just making something weird happen. And you know, I don't know, I feel like you can't, I guess you could do that in other places, but I don't know, I just feel like there's a weird charm to that.
You can, but I think that's the charm, whatever your region is that, yeah, everyone in the Southeast right now that is doing this full-time or otherwise, it comes down to passion. And a lot of times when you go to New York, yep, or LA, I mean, you arrive in those spaces because of that, but you become a cog in an established industry. Here, out here in flyover country, whatever you want to call it, there's no cogs that's been established yet. We're wearing a lot of different hats when we show up on productions, and we have expertise in very different areas, where in New York or LA, you could literally do the same job for 30 yeah. years, even now. And I think that's the best thing in the universe, because when you're on one set and people you're meeting or people you've worked with before from your area are in that set, and then the next set, it's this, almost the same cast of characters, but like everyone's doing different jobs. I think it leads to a much, it's more like a, instead of a job, it's more like a summer camp.
Yes. I think that's actually a really good way to put it, because like with my movies, I'm usually losing money, and I'm not, you know, afraid to admit that. Like, I think that's pretty commonplace, but you know, I still get up the next day and do it again and write another kooky script, maybe with a panda bear like I did, and then do it again. And like, and I'm sure I'll cook up something else down the road. And like, there's some strange magic to that. And like, you know, sometimes I'm working with non-actors, sometimes I'm working with actors who've been acting for 30 plus years. And, you know, it's an interesting region to make stuff. And, you know, I enjoy doing it because I think people almost don't expect it to happen. They're like, oh, I don't know that you could. I didn't know you could do that. And I'm like, if you like sweating in North Carolina heat and making, you know, just eating pizza for 5 days straight, you can do it too. Like, you know,
it's like heaven.
It is. It's like I think the summer camp analogy is great. Like, you know, obviously I respect the fact that there are people who do this professionally. You know, I do it to make a living as well, not always in my own films, but in other people's and, you know, commercial stuff. And like, you know, it's important to be professional, but at the same time, I think there is, like you said, a passion and love for the craft that you're just maybe sometimes not going to find as much in the places where people just show up and they're saying, all right, when do we go home, looking at the watch? And
yeah, you know. Yeah. And I've been on a few of those sets. Believe me, they're torturous.
I have too. There was about a year where I did almost exclusively those types of sets. And I was miserable, and you know, I wasn't doing anything for myself, and there, that was the spell where I was like, well, you know, I graduated from film school, I'm gonna do the thing that everyone's supposed to do. And I immediately regretted that decision and just started making my own stuff here. And you know, I'm not gonna say it's been the best, easiest road to getting it seen, but I think creative fulfilling wise I think it has set me down a path where I'm excited to see, you know, how I grow as an artist. And I'm you know, sure you feel the same way with what you're doing.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I think having your own space to create is part of the key to surviving this industry. Cause if you're doing someone else, I mean, it depends. I mean, if you're above the line or a production designer or something like that, you're getting a creative input somewhere, and maybe that's enough. And some people really can flourish in those environments. But if you show up and you're carrying sandbags every day for a year, for somebody else, and you have no control or input or anything except how to drape it onto the C-stand leg, then I imagine this is a weird, miserable industry. And for some people, it is, man. I see a lot of burnout. And I think it's important to have your corner. I need to go work on this stuff. I need you to help me. I can help you, you know, get in there and get weird. Add a panda bear to your script, which sounds awesome.
I'll send you the movie if you have 60 minutes. So.
Please, I want to watch it. Anything with a panda bear as a character has already got my attention.
Cool. It's in a mascot costume, so it's even weirder. The costume is literally as cheap as we could afford, so it's falling apart. But I think it adds to the charm of the weirdness. Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. So speaking of burnout, not to bring the tone down and depressing, but just how do you deal with that? Because I've hit different spells of burnout, if I'm being honest. And, you know, some have been harder than others. Like some I can really shake myself out of with a good movie. Others really seem to like, you know, kind of be something I'm carrying around like a bowling ball in a bag.
It is very real. It is the worst thing about this profession because the hours can be long and amorphous. Like all the kind of work you do creatively is really amorphous. The thing I try to do is, I don't know how to describe. I'm always reading a book. Like at night, I have my reading time. It is not about filmmaking. It's about all the other topics in the world. So that gives me enough juice sometimes. Watching movies definitely helps. But a lot of times I need to put my creative space in a place where I'm not in charge of the creative space.
Yeah.
And I think that helps. You know, go live in someone else's idea for a minute, especially writing for me, because it's a long, slow move through their creative space. And then you just go to visit some other imagination, visit some other creative space for a while. When you come back out of that, things are going to feel different. It's a bit like going on vacation. You know, if you're out for 2 weeks somewhere and you come back home, home is a little bit different than when you left it mentally, not physically, but like that helps. Take a break, check out. If you got to step away from the industry, then, and I've seen this dozens of times, people go out for 6 months or a year and then they get back into it and they're like, oh yeah, I feel much better. It's like, yeah, you needed some time, buddy. That's usually what it is. So like maybe the most important thing to schedule is on the regular that time. So you're not even going to flirt with the burnout, you know?
Yeah, no, that's great advice. I love, reading. I obviously, like everyone, I wish I did it more, but you know, anytime I really sit down and I read, like I was reading the other night and I got lost in a book for like 3 hours. And when I came out of the book, I literally felt like I just had like a massage or something. Like
that's exactly it. It didn't matter if you're an accountant or some other job, like you need to step away. And like creating movies is one of the hardest things to do in this culture professionally, because it's money, it's time, it's collaboration. It's so hard to move the ball down the field. You need to structure some time for yourself somewhere so you can check out, because otherwise the burnout's just going to happen faster, I think.
Yeah, well, and I think the collaboration and the money and all that, like the collaboration specifically, I think is the best and sometimes also most challenging part of filmmaking, because sometimes, I don't know if you feel this way, I get almost like jealous. I'm like, oh, if I was a painter, I could just sit in this room and I could paint to my heart's content, and that's the art. And then I'm done. I don't have to, I mean, you know, obviously you have to get it out there, but you know, that process can be in the room.
Like it's different. It's like, if you sit down to write a book, which I've thought about, and painting, which I've very much thought about, you don't have the sound guy telling you, he's like, no, do it this way.
Yeah.
The guy, I'm you know, that,
and or it's, an airplane flying over ruining your,
And it's not to badmouth those positions, because film is a collaborative support. You can't do that by yourself. I don't believe in the Artur thing, but if you're a painter, then yeah, that's exactly how it works. You know, it's just you and the paintbrushes, so to speak. So yeah, I do sometimes, but the collaboration is the most rewarding part. It is also hard to wrangle. So
it is. Yeah, no. Well, it's interesting because I always, you know, when I finish a film, I'm always on a high. I'm always feeling great. I'm like, we did it. I feel like we defied logic. Like logic says that should not have happened. Like somehow we pulled it off. We're all a little sleep deprived, over caffeinated, but you know, it did happen, and it's beautiful. But you know, sometimes too, I think that's where it's interesting to, like, you know, do this podcast or, you know, read, or, you know, I've also thought about writing a book, and like, you know, that's the type of thing where, you know, I think it's okay to be a filmmaker slash, like if you need to do another thing for a minute or, you know, work your schedule where you're doing filmmaking 3 days a week and writing 2 days a week and then taking, you know, 2 more days off, or is that 7 days? Math is not my strongest suit. So, you know, but yeah, like that whole situation, I think it's important. And, you know, I think it's necessary, like as creative people, to just keep our brains sane, you know?
So, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, man, thank you. I really appreciate this. I appreciate your time and joining me on the podcast. To kind of land the plane, this is my final question I ask everyone. What advice would you give to someone wanting to motivate themselves to be creative, do this crazy creative thing that we do? And how do you convince yourself to be creative at the end of the day? It's a fun question.
Pick up the tool of your medium and play. Don't worry about what other people will think. Most of the time, they're not going to think anything. Just do it for yourself and play in the medium. If it's filmmaking, pick up a camera and go crazy. With YouTube and especially TikTok, I'm goofing off on TikTok now, trying to figure that out. You have no excuse not to play and figure out where your strengths are, if it's something you're gonna be good at, or just how the mechanics of it works. It's easier now than ever. What was your second question? What was the second half of that question?
How do you convince yourself to be creative at the end of the day?
It's a compulsion, man. I was always the kid in elementary school that would check out animal books from the library, and then all about elephants, and then I would tell people for a week, did you know they're called pachyderms? Did you know their trunk is a nose? And I have the same problem, except now it's been more adult sculpted and sophisticated, where I want to have a conversation with the planet about X or Y. Right. And that really, to me, is what filmmaking is. It's a conversation with an audience. What am I trying to say? What are we trying to say? And I just feel compelled to do that. And I don't need a lot of motivation. I do need things to get easier. Corporate videos and the stuff you got to do to survive, that managing all that is why this is a professional thing and not just goofing off all the time, is
right.
And figuring out that's how you motivate yourself, in my opinion. Because like, if I had $1 million and no barriers, buddy, I'd be pumping stuff out left and right, like all about elephant noses and manatees and stories from ancient Mexico or something like that.
Yeah, I would be flying to, you know, wherever the closest giraffe was and making a video. Giraffes are like one of my favorite animals on the planet, just because they're so weird. They should not exist. They don't make sense. But
they're so bizarre.
Yeah.
No one should get to that top of shelf.
Yes.
It's unnatural.
Yeah. It doesn't. It defies logic, but that's why it catches my attention span. But dude, no, this was an awesome episode. Thank you for taking part, Kyle. Where can folks keep up with you if they want to see your films and keep up with what you're doing?
My pleasure. Thank you for having me on. To find me, I am on most social media platforms under Neo Teotihuacan, NeoTeotihuacan. Feel free to rewind and listen to that again. But you could also find me at screendoorpictures.com, I guess, and trexpertise.com. I live there. But yeah, you can find me in any of those areas.
Perfect. Perfect. We all go check out Kyle's stuff. Thank you for listening. If you want to keep up with what we're doing, we have new episodes coming out for the rest of the season. Give us a rating on iTunes, subscribe to us on YouTube, all that good stuff, convincingcreatives.com. And we'll see you all in the next episode. Take care.